The Charterhouse of Parma by Stendhal. Read by Nicholas Boulton for Naxos Audiobooks. Preface. To the reader. It was in the winter of 1830 and 300 leagues from Paris that this tale was written. Thus it contains no allusion to the events of 1839. Many years before 1830, at the time when our armies were overrunning Europe, chance put me in possession of a billeting order on the house of a canon. This was at Padua, a charming town in Italy. My stay being prolonged, we became friends. Passing through Padua again towards the end of 1830, I hastened to the house of the good canon. He himself was dead, that I knew, but I wished to see once again the room in which we had passed so many pleasant evenings, evenings on which I had often looked back since. I found there the canon's nephew and his wife, who welcomed me like an old friend. Several people came in, and we did not break up until a very late hour. The nephew sent out to the Café Pedrocchi for an excellent zabaione. What more than anything kept us up was the story of the Duchessa Sanseverina, to which someone made an allusion, and which the nephew was good enough to relate from beginning to end in my honour. In the place to which I am going, I told my friends, I am not likely to find evenings like this, and to while away the long hours of darkness, I shall make a novel out of your story. In that case, said the nephew, let me give you my uncle's journal, which, under the heading Parma, mentions several of the intrigues of that court, in the days when the Duchessa's word was law there. But have a care, this story is anything but moral, and now that you pride yourselves in France on your gospel purity, it may win you the reputation of an assassin. I publish this tale without any alteration from the manuscript of 1830, a course which may have two drawbacks. The first, for the reader. The characters being Italians will perhaps interest him less, hearts in that country differing considerably from hearts in France. The Italians are sincere, honest folk, and not taking offence, say what is in their minds. It is only when the mood seizes them that they show any vanity, which then becomes passion and goes by the name of puntiglio. Lastly, poverty is not with them a subject for ridicule. The second drawback concerns the author. I confess that I have been so bold as to leave my characters with their natural asperities, but on the other hand, this I proclaim aloud, I heap the most moral censure upon many of their actions. To what purpose should I give them the exalted morality and other graces of French characters, who love money above all things and sin scarcely ever from motives of hatred or love? The Italians in this tale are almost the opposite. Besides, it seems to me that whenever one takes a stride of 200 leagues from south to north, the change of scene that occurs is tantamount to a fresh tale. The canon's charming niece had known and indeed had been greatly devoted to the Duchessa Sanseverina, and begs me to alter nothing in her adventures, which are reprehensible. 23rd of January, 1839. Chapter 1. On the 15th of May, 1796, General Bonaparte made his entry into Milan at the head of that young army which had shortly before crossed the Bridge of Lodi and taught the world that after all these centuries, Caesar and Alexander had a successor. The miracles of gallantry and genius of which Italy was a witness in the space of a few months aroused a slumbering people. Only a week before the arrival of the French, the Milanese still regarded them as a mere rabble of brigands, accustomed invariably to flee before the troops of his imperial and royal majesty. So much, at least, was reported to them, three times weekly, by a little news sheet no bigger than one's hand and printed on soiled paper. In the Middle Ages, the Republicans of Lombardy had given proof of a valour equal to that of the French, and deserved to see their city razed to the ground by the German emperors. Since they had become loyal subjects, their great occupation was the printing of sonnets upon handkerchiefs of rose-coloured taffeta whenever the marriage occurred of a young lady belonging to some rich or noble family. 2 or 3 years after that great event in her life, the young lady in question used to engage a devoted admirer. Sometimes the name of the cicisbeo, chosen by the husband's family, occupied an honourable place in the marriage contract. It was a far cry from these effeminate ways to the profound emotions aroused by the unexpected arrival of the French army. Presently, there sprang up a new and passionate way of life. A whole people discovered on the 15th of May 1796 that everything which until then it had respected was supremely ridiculous, if not actually hateful. The departure of the last Austrian regiment marked the collapse of the old ideas. To risk one's life became the fashion. People saw that in order to be really happy after centuries of cloying sensations, it was necessary to love one's country with a real love and to seek out heroic actions. They had been plunged in the darkest night by the continuation of the jealous despotism of Charles V and Philip II. They overturned these monarchs' statues and immediately found themselves flooded with daylight. For the last half century, as the Encyclopedia and Voltaire gained ground in France, the monks had been dinning into the ears of the good people of Milan that to learn to read, or for that matter to learn anything at all, was a great waste of labour, and that by paying one's exact tithe to one's parish priest and faithfully reporting to him all one's little misdeeds, one was practically certain of having a good place in paradise. To complete the debilitation of this people, once so formidable and so rational, Austria had sold them on easy terms the privilege of not having to furnish any recruits to her army. In 1796, the Milanese army was composed of 24 rapscallions dressed in scarlet, who guarded the town with the assistance of 4 magnificent regiments of Hungarian grenadiers. Freedom of morals was extreme, but passion very rare. Otherwise, apart from the inconvenience of having to repeat everything to one's parish priest on pain of ruin even in this world, the good people of Milan were still subjected to certain little monarchical interferences which could not fail to be vexatious. For instance, the Archduke, who resided at Milan and governed in the name of the Emperor his cousin, had had the lucrative idea of trading in corn. In consequence, an order prohibiting the peasants from selling their grain until His Highness had filled his granaries. In May 1796, 3 days after the entry of the French, a young painter in miniature, slightly mad, named Gros, afterwards famous, who had come with the army, overhearing in the great Café des Servi, which was then in fashion, an account of the exploits of the Archduke, who moreover was extremely stout, picked up the list of ices which was printed on a sheet of coarse yellow paper. On the back of this, he drew the fat Archduke. A French soldier was stabbing him with his bayonet in the stomach, and instead of blood, there gushed out an incredible quantity of corn. What we call a lampoon or caricature was unknown in this land of crafty despotism. The drawing left by Gros on the table of the Café des Servi seemed a miracle fallen from heaven. It was engraved and printed during the night, and next day 20,000 copies of it were sold. The same day, there were posted up notices of a forced loan of 6 millions levied to supply the needs of the French army, which, having just won 6 battles and conquered a score of provinces, wanted nothing now but shoes, breeches, jackets, and caps. The mass of prosperity and pleasure which burst into Lombardy in the wake of these French ragamuffins was so great that only the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.